Any announcement?
Yes, ma'am. The fourth session of this series of talks on cultivating spiritual qualities, a very important topic of self-effort and divine grace.
Om Bhadram Karne Vishinuamo Devaha Bhadram Pashe Maksha Virjajatraha Sthirai Rangai Istustu Vagam Shastano Vihi Vashema Devahitam Yadayhu Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. May we hear with our ears what is auspicious. May we see with our eyes what is beneficial. May we sing praises to the Lord and enjoy with strong limbs and body the life assigned to us by Him. Om Peace, Peace, Peace. The subject, as it has been announced, is self-effort and divine grace. In spiritual context, the divine grace can be studied in three stages. First is this grace necessary to become a spiritual aspirant. There are many people and who are not seeking God. So if somebody is seeking God, it itself is a divine grace that is granted. Second is that grace needed for spiritual practice. That means after that, if somebody is spiritual aspirant, then he should get some guidance or some innate impetus. That means from his own side, from his heart, he should get an inspiration to do spiritual practices. And third is the most important, which is grace necessary for the ultimate illumination. That means you can say for experiences. So our situation or our status can be said in this way, and it is like this. Shankaracharya has said in his book Vivek Churavani, Durlabham Trayame Vaita Devanugraha Hetukam Manushyattam Mumukshyattam Mahapurusha Samsara. That means human birth, longing for liberation and association of the holy person. These are considered to be available, or if we have, we can think that we have received the grace of God. So first is that human birth. We know we are human beings, so we have a human birth. Then longing for liberation, that is the most important part. Whether we have, what type of longing we have, whether we have at all any longing, or to what extent actually it can be increased, all those things need to be explored. And of course, as a part of that, association of the holy person, because they only guide us. Otherwise, it is not possible to progress in spiritual life. Of course, to some extent, we can definitely progress by keeping association with literature and scripture and by our own effort. That means with our own understanding, whatever we know that much, if we practice, that is also important. But definitely, things develop when we find a person who can ably guide us. Now let us see how actually it works. In case of, just two example that we know, that how this Mahapurusha Samsara, that I just wanted to give two instances. In the life of Swami Vivekananda, we see that he was seeking, and definitely he was trying his best to understand God and practice something. But ultimately it so happened that when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, then things actually worked. That is the point. And how did he, how that situation came? It came in this way, that Sri Ramakrishna was visiting the area where Swami Vivekananda, at that time Narendranath, used to live. And his distant relative, Ramchandra Datto, was a great devotee of Sri Ramakrishna. He had invited him to his place. That means invited Sri Ramakrishna to his place. Sri Ramakrishna used to visit in this way, your devotees' houses. So to entertain Sri Ramakrishna with divine songs, he invited Narendranath at that time. He was a college student. He did not know, of course, I don't think that he never heard of him, but that was the opportunity of meeting Sri Ramakrishna. So he sang songs, and Sri Ramakrishna actually was very much impressed by that, and later on he said, just come to me, and that he honored. That means he went to Sri Ramakrishna, and in that way this Mahapurusha Samsara actually worked for him in this way. Then in case of Swami Brahmananda, at that time Rakhal, so he was married to a devotee's what is called, he was married to a devotee, not in this way, that means she was married to a devotee's son actually. So when the marriage ceremony was done, so they were coming, and the son was also devotee. So they came and they thought that first let us go and bow down to Sri Ramakrishna. So in that way, I think I got a little bit mixed up. It is this way, that means the sister of one of the devotees of Sri Ramakrishna got married with Rakhal, and they were coming from the, what is called the bride's house. And at that time the bride's brother thought he was a devotee, so he wanted to pay respect to Sri Ramakrishna. So they came to Dakshineswar, and at that time Sri Ramakrishna saw Rakhal, and by seeing actually Sri Ramakrishna understood that he is a spiritual potential. He had some other, what is called, hints, and ultimately he started coming, and in that way spiritual, he blossomed. That means ultimately we see that he became a great spiritual personality. So in this way actually things happen, and in a retrospective way we can see that Mahapurusha Samsara in that way happened in this life, and in that way they became great spiritual personalities. Now for us, let us see. Second, as I told you, grace needed for spiritual practice. So whether self-effort is sufficient, we know that we have to make effort, we come to the conclusion, whether that will be sufficient or not. Then we may think that whether the divine grace alone is necessary. We do spiritual practice but we do not progress, then we feel that, well, there is no divine grace, that is probably it is not happening. Probably divine grace is the most important part that we need to we expect. So in that way we may think, but point is that when we go to the literature of spiritual practices or different lives, the great spiritual personalities' lives, we see that they actually made some effort, that is why that they got the divine grace. So the point is that to get divine grace we need to have need to do some effort. That's the point. So let me share some of the thoughts that have been passed to us by great spiritual personalities. This is God's grace in Hinduism. In the light of the doctrine of karma, it may seem that man is responsible for whatever happens to him in his life in the form of pleasure or pain. So we know the karma theory is a great theory that Hindus believe, and in that way you can think that whatever you get is the result of our action, whether it is good and whatever is bad, whatever it may be. So past actions give the result. Since God is only the giver of man's karma follow, that means he is the giver of what we are getting, his role is no different from the role of a cashier in a bank. That means he is the dispenser only. He does not interfere with the what is called action and the result. We do our action, we get the result, and he is the dispenser, just like a cashier in the bank. The cashier cannot give any money to the depositor other than his invested capital and its interest. Then where is the scope of God's grace in Hinduism? So where actually God comes into the in play? So if we get our results of our actions, so if God is not there, then actually what we are doing, we shall get the result. So that is the belief. But from the point of view of theology, that means from the point of spiritual literature, we see that God, because of the presence of God, actually these things are happening. That means the cashier gives the money because probably the bank is there, or the bank means a group of people are there who actually is controlling bank, and in that way it is happening. So his presence is not seen, But indirectly, actually, he is giving the result. Because of his presence, we are getting the money. But still, it is dependent upon our own investment, if you call it. That means what we have done, that is being given to us. In reply, Hinduism says that grace cannot be conditional. If we think of the grace, actually you cannot imagine that the word grace itself means that means something which is given without any condition. That means it will come of its own and we shall get the benefit. And it does not, it should not have anything that is connected with the, any past thing, past actions. Any conditional gift cannot be called a real grace. Therefore, God's grace has to be unconditional, unbiased, and impartial. Just as the sun shines on both the good and the wicked, so also God showers His grace impartially on everyone, whether good or evil. The good use of God's grace for good purposes, the wicked uses God's grace for bad purposes. That is the point. That means God's grace is always there, and according to the individual's motivation, if you call it, actually they are utilizing that grace. So there is a good example that Sri Ramakrishna has given. That means one person is what is called studying Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, in the light of a lamp. So another person is also using that light of the lamp for forging bank bills. That may, in that way it may happen. So the light is there, light is impartial. It is just being shining. And it is the way it is being utilized, in that way actually things happen. According to Sri Ramakrishna, the breeze of grace, God's grace is always blowing. Everyone in this world is like the owner of a sailboat. So we are sailboats, actually we are owner of a sailboat, and we can just use the breeze that is always blowing. As long as the sail of the boat is not unfurled, one cannot take advantage of the breeze. One cannot get the benefit of God's grace. But as soon as the sail is unfurled, the breeze of the divine grace starts moving the boat. So this is the way we have to see the God's grace. That means God's grace is always there, but the way we utilize it, actually we get that benefit. In this analogy, the act of unfurling the sail is no other than making self-effort. Without self-effort, one will neither be able to appreciate nor enjoy the benefit of God's grace. So in that way, materials are available. That means everything that is needed for doing spiritual practices are available in abundance. I have my own theory. If I find time, I shall share that with you. But definitely, from the point of view of our teachings that have been passed through our teachers, we know that always there is availability. It is always available. That means grace is always available. It is a matter of our making our own effort. What we term self-effort and divine grace supplement each other. We cannot have the one without the other from our point of view. That means from the point of view of a seeker, that means spiritual, a person who is doing spiritual practice, who has not reached the highest, and also who is really ignorant about spirituality. Minus these two, actually everybody who wants to progress in spiritual life, they should know that without self-effort, this cannot be obtained. We cannot have the one without the other. Without intense and unremitting striving on our part, we can never experience divine grace. Mere prayer without corresponding effort will not bear fruit. It will be just like the man who, finding his house on fire, started praying for rain instead of trying to put the fire out through means available then and there. So it is like this. This is a very good example. That means suppose there is fire in our house. So instead of God is there, so we can pray to God, we start praying and He'll come to put out the fire. It does not happen. So we have to make our own effort, but at the same time we need to pray to God also. The proper thing is to do all we can and also to pray. So this is the stand of a spiritual seeker. That means divine grace is definitely there, but at the same time we need to make our own effort. All our spiritual teachers declare unanimously that the soul in its essential nature is pure spirit. Owing to ignorance, the spirit forgets itself, becomes identified with ego, with the mind and the senses, with attachment and aversion, with the sense of aversion, with the sense objects, with the body and its functions, all products of ignorance. That is the concept in our spiritual literature. That means soul is always pure and it is getting involved with the mind, body, senses, and in that way actually mind, soul is really, the consciousness of soul is going downward. It is not remaining in its own position. That is the problem. The Atman puts on the masks of causal body, subtle body and the gross body. These are concepts that are there. There is a causal body and there is the what is called subtle body and also the gross body. Gross body means that the body is the senses. It is the mass that become impure, not the Atman. The ego, the mind and the body may be defiled, but the spirit ever remains pure and enlightened and free. So this is a very good concept that has come down to us. That means we have an aspect of what is called purity within ourselves. That means which never is defiled. But we are ignorant of that. And because of our ignorance actually, we do not see that. And why we do not see? Because there is a veil. That means we have put the veil, it has been said, mask about mind, body and senses. So this is the problem that we need to address. An illustration of Sri Ramakrishna helps us to understand this better. The body is like a vessel. The mind is like water in it. Brahman is like the sun that is reflected in the water. The water may be impure and disturbed, but the light of the sun ever remains shining and pure. So according to the quality of the water, the situation of the water, the reflection will be there. We cannot think that the sun is impure. It is always there, pure. The Kathaka Upanishad says, quote, as the sun which follows the eye of the universe is never defiled by the external impurities seen by the eyes, so the oneself that resides in all beings is never touched by evils of the world. So this is a quote from the Kathaka Upanishad. So we can understand on the strength of these sayings of the great teacher, that means soul is always impure. That means, and also it is with us. That means it is not really somewhere else that we have to go and find it out. It is always with us. No impurity can affect our primary nature, which ever remains pure. That means soul cannot be defiled. That is the point. It is our second nature that becomes impure, and it can and should be purified. Second nature means the mind, body, senses, all those things actually are impure layers that is covering that pure soul. So they need to be purified. That is the point. Spiritual life is the cleansing of this second nature of ours, the cleansing of the mask, the coverings of the ego, the mind and the body. So there is certainly hope for every one of us. It is rightly said that even as every saint has a past, so has every sinner a future. So because we are carrying that purity within ourselves, but only we have covered it with the, what is called the ignorance. So if the ignorance is removed, the soul will come out and we shall realize our true self. In the Bhagavad Gita, Sri Krishna gives this categorical assurance. So he says, Apiche sudaracharo bhajate mam ananabhag sadhu reva samantabha sammak vyavasita hisa. So this is an assurance. He is saying, even the most sinful amongst people, if that person worships me, the Supreme Spirit, with unswerving devotion, must be regarded as virtuous, for that person has resolved rightly. So a person who may be very, what is called, bad outwardly, and he is not doing any spiritual practice, not only then practicing vices and all those things, but if he has taken a little turn towards God, so Lord Krishna is saying that he should be praised, that means should be appreciated that he has turned to God. Then the second verse he is saying, Shipram bhavati dharmatma shashat chanting nivachati Kauntya pratijanahi name bhakta pranashyati. So he is saying to Arjuna that proclaim, soon the person becomes righteous and attains eternal peace. Proclaim it boldly that my devotee is never destroyed. So little bit of spirituality, if somebody is practicing, actually he is, there is a potentiality, he will be reaching me. And for that actually we need to appreciate that. That is the point. Lord Krishna said, proclaim it boldly that my devotee is never destroyed. It elsewhere also Lord Krishna has said that salpam alpasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhaya. That means if somebody has done lot of vices, that means at the time of committing vice means actually at the time of death will be so much afraid of death that he will die of that fear. But if he has taken a turn, he has made a little good deed, that means a little bit of virtuous thing, actually there is a hope for him. The Lord himself removes all obstacles for the devotee who has completely surrendered to him. So there are many stories, and we know some stories are very worth repeating. That is the point. A glorious illustration of how a most simple person can become righteous and attain the highest illumination and peace through the grace of Supreme Spirit is seen in the life of Girishchandra Ghosh. That means we are devotees of Sri Ramakrishna, and most of us are familiar with the life of Girishchandra Ghosh, and that is a very exemplary incident, or he was an exemplary devotee, how actually grace worked for him. Let me repeat it. The glorious illustration of how a most simple person can become righteous and attain the highest illumination and peace through the grace of the Supreme Spirit is seen in the life of Girishchandra Ghosh, the famous actor, dramatist and a great disciple of Sri Ramakrishna. According to his own statement, that means later on in the before his passing away, if you call it, that means after the passing away of Sri Ramakrishna, he lived more years, so he had said like this. According to his own statement, there was no sin that Girish Ghosh did not commit. That means he was so full of vice when he came to Sri Ramakrishna. At one time, he considered religion a fraud. Later, however, a great change came over him and there grew a deep yearning for spiritual light and peace. So at the beginning, that means he did not believe in religion. Not only he thought that those who are practicing religion are hypocrites. In that way, he had the impression. It was then that he was drawn to Sri Ramakrishna. Gradually, his mind became purified, though he had to go a long way. Once the following conversation took place. Girish, that means conversation between Sri Ramakrishna and Girishchandra Ghosh. Girish, sir, please bless me. Master, have faith in Divine Mother and you will attain everything. Girish, but I am a sinner. Master, the rage who constantly harps on sin becomes a sinner. Girish, sir, the very ground where I sit becomes unholy. Master, how can you say that? Suppose a light is brought into a room that had been dark 1,000 years. Does it illumine the room little by little or in a flash? Girish, still continuing, is saying, I have no sincerity, please grant it to me. So you can see how, what is his attitude. That means he never thought that he can attain to any spirituality or can convert him or change him. Master, all right, you have faith. So ultimately Sri Ramakrishna understood he has surrendered or whatever it may be, that he has great faith in him. So he understood his position. Young Narendra, who later became Swami Vivekananda, was very friendly with Girishchandra and was warned by Master not to associate with him too much. Quote, Girish is like a cup in which garlic is kept. You may wash it 1,000 times, but can never get rid of the smell altogether. That means they are young disciples, so naturally Sri Ramakrishna had to protect them. And Girish Ghosh was so much full of bias that he warned Narayanatha to associate with him because he has become a devotee or he is really surrendered to him. So he warned him. Girish heard this and felt offended. He asked the master if the garlic smell would go at all. The master assured him, quote, "All the smell disappears when a blazing fire is lighted. If you hit the cup in the fire, you will get rid of the smell." So if the spirituality is very intense, actually all the vices will be burnt up. That is the point Sri Ramakrishna is saying. And he declared that people would be astounded at the marvelous change that would come over Girish. So he foresaw, that means Sri Ramakrishna had that what is called hunch, if you call it, that means he knew that because of his strong faith, Girish will be able to overcome all the vices that he had, not only that, he will be a shining example of a great convert. The garlic smell did disappear in due course and he became wonderfully transformed. Directed by the master, Girish followed the path of absolute surrender to the divine will, a path very well, a very few can follow. This self-surrender, actually, you know, we mentally say we have surrendered to God. That is a sort of word of our what is called timidity. That means we do not want to practice anything. That is why so we have surrendered, God will take care in that way. That is the one. But surrendering oneself to God is really very serious thing, serious effort in depth. So Girish Ghosh actually, you know, he was a very staunch, he was very strong in mind. So when he said, Sri Ramakrishna said, surrender to me, or he said that I am surrendering to you, he meant that actually. So directed by the master, Girish followed the path of absolute self-surrender to the divine will, a path very few can follow. He would not promise to undergo even the simplest spiritual discipline and was very happy when Sri Ramakrishna asked him to give the power of atonement. That is the extreme type of self-surrender. That means you cannot imagine that you can think that I have not to do anything. The person whom actually have given the power, attorney will do on your behalf whatever is necessary. In that way, he gave all the responsibility of spiritual practices to Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna gladly accepted that. Sri Ramakrishna asked him to give the power of attorney and promised to assume all responsibility for his spiritual life. So you can see it is a great grace. Definitely Sri Ramakrishna accepted all the responsibility of such a person, and that actually see what will happen. Girish at that time thought that the path of self-surrender was the easiest, but later on realized what a most exacting thing it was. So he was very intelligent, that means he was considered, his brain was very sharp. So when he had done that, at that time he did not understand what he is doing, but later on actually when he started thinking what he has done, actually he thought that it is very difficult. Not only difficult, that means it requires a lot of effort to practice self-surrender. So he said he had to practice self-surrender every moment. As a result of this, however, he felt continually the presence of the Lord and became a man of God. The Lord had removed all his vices, his obstacles in the spiritual path, and filled his soul with his long divine presence. On Girish Ghosh's part, as you can see, that was the practice of self-surrender. And not only that, Girish Ghosh, being an intelligent person, understood, if I have surrendered myself entirely to Sri Ramakrishna, I don't have power to do anything. So in that way, actually, he had to think of that Sri Ramakrishna will take care of this, take care of that. He's taking care of this, so he cannot interfere also. And that repeated thinking of Sri Ramakrishna actually changed him. That means you think of God, you think of your chosen ideal, and that purifies the mind. In that way, transformation occurred in him. The last time some of us saw Girish Ghosh, the writer actually had the opportunity of seeing Girish Ghosh towards the end of his life. So he told us, quote, "As I move my hand, I feel that it is not I, but the Lord who is moving it." So he had that type of feeling. That means that type of that self-surrender actually brought him to that point, That means even he could not think of Sri Ramakrishna when he was doing any act. Even the moving of the finger, he had to think of Sri Ramakrishna because he has surrendered himself without his consent or without his, he is moving his hand and what is called fingers. His eyes and face, that means that is the quote, that ends the quote. His eyes and face were radiant with the glow of his inner illumination and unbounded love for the Lord. This is one of the most sublime illustrations of transformation brought about the divine grace. So it is definitely a great example of divine grace, which flows into the spiritual seeker as he strives to his utmost. So this is considered to be a great example of how extreme self-surrender automatically brings divine grace. Now let us see, I have one on this subject, Girish Ghosh himself actually has spoken. So I have that I shall read that, but let us start to Holy Mother Sarasvati Devi, what she has said. The supreme reality of God is like the sun. It reflects itself on the pure mind with the help of an illuminating conversation between a devotee and Sri Saradevi. The spiritual concept of Sri Ramakrishna, also known as the Holy Mother, we can clearly understand the connection between spiritual practice and divine grace. That means self-effort. Practice means effort. So spiritual, that means spiritual practice means self-effort. That means a seeker needs to do practice, and that is effort. Devotee is asking, devotee, quote, Mother, how does one realize God? Worship, japa, meditation, do these help one? Mother, none of this can help. Devotee, then how does one attain to the wisdom of God? Mother, it is only through his grace. But one must practice meditation and japa that removes the impurities of the mind. One must practice spiritual disciplines such as worship and so forth. As one gets the fragrance of a flower by handling it, as one gets the fragrance of sandalwood by rubbing it against a stone, in the same way one gets spiritual awakening by constantly thinking of God. But you can realize him right now if you become free from desire. So this is a very enlightening advice that, or observation that Holy Mother gave. It is there always. Then if the point is that as you really progress in spiritual practices, you will feel the presence of God. In that way, the divine grace is always with you, but you have to make effort, just like pasting of the sandalwood like that. And not only that, he has given another clue that if you somehow can become devoid of any desire, at this moment actually, you will realize that it will see. The mind has become soiled by worldliness. Spiritual practices remove the impurities. And then, just as the clear mirror reflects the shining sun in all its glory, the divine spirit is revealed clearly in the purified mind in a spontaneous way. So this is the principle, if you call it, and what you learn from Holy Mother is saying. Here, one point must be plainly understood. The purity attained through spiritual disciplines may be of a very high order, but it is not perfect. The spiritual seeker is established in perfect purity only after divine realization, when objects of temptation become unreal and the Supreme Spirit remains the only reality. That is why Sri Krishna declares in the Bhagavad Gita, Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehino raso varjam raso pyasya param dishta nivartate. That means, it is in the second chapter, it is there. Sense objects received from the abstinent person, but the taste for them lingers still. Where with the realization of the Supreme Spirit, even the taste disappears. So it is a little bit of what is called final aspect of the self-realization, you can say. We can make all effort to clean our mind by doing spiritual practices and all those things. But the point is that ultimate realization, that means ultimate what is called clarity, if you call it purity, will come after the self-realization. That is a stamp of what is called perfection. That will come after self-realization. It is necessary for us to understand the relation between spiritual practice to divine grace, and the important part they play in our lives in removing our inner obstacles. Then only can we feel enthusiastic about disciplines which we ordinarily undergo in a haphazard way. So the writer is saying that if we can really clearly understand what is the position of this self-effort, that means spiritual discipline, practice of self, spiritual discipline, and what is the position of the divine grace, which actually all the people will say that without divine grace we cannot have self-realization. So if we know properly their positions, then it will become good for us, and we can really make our effort in a concerted way, not in a haphazard way. Once a disciple asked the Holy Mother about the utility of spiritual practice. She replied, "Through these spiritual disciplines, the ties of past karma are cut asunder. By these disciplines, the turbulence of the sense organs is subdued." So that is why spiritual practices are necessary. That means it will actually control the mind, and in that way the past karma will not be able to act. Devotee, can action ever cancel action? This is a very important question. That means it is also a theological question. Whether an action can really overcome or cancel past action. Actually, it cannot. That means if you believe into the theory of karma, actually it does not happen. It cannot, it will not be possible. Holy Mother also said in a different context. But the point is that the effect will be very less. Past action, if the past action, Holy Mother has said that this person was to lose his leg because of the past action, if you call it. So because of doing his spiritual practices, probably he will have a prick of a thorn in his leg. In that way, it will be there. That means it cannot be nullified at all. But its effect can be nullified in this way. Mother, why not? So he is saying that devotee asked, can action ever cancel action? Mother, why not? If you do a good action, that will counteract your past evil action. Past sins can be counteracted by meditation, japa, and spiritual thought. So in that way, actually, when the mind actually completely changes, it becomes pure, actually, the effect of the past action will be much less. It is a matter of experience that to the extent we succeed in making our mind pure through moral and spiritual struggle, we feel the flow of divine grace. So that is true. Divine grace is there. So we make our mind pure and we feel that we shall be able to feel the grace within ourselves. So the point is that relationship is like that. It is not that this because of our what is called work or a spiritual discipline that we have practiced, the grace has, we can see the grace. Indirectly it is, but it is there, and the perception actually comes into play when we do spiritual practices. Swami Brahmananda used to tell, to obtain God's grace is the most important aid in the spiritual life. The breeze of grace is always blowing. Just unfurl yourself. This is of course, Sri Ramakrishna also said, Holy Mother also has said, it's a very common quote about divine grace and effort, self-effort. This means that we should keep ourselves open to the divine grace, the cosmic spiritual current, by attaining purity through the performance of regular spiritual practice. So in that way, these two go hand in hand. Now I told you that I shall share Girish Ghosh's own observation about Sri Ramakrishna's grace that he had obtained and how it worked for him. That will be interesting to know. This has happened, you know, when the Ramakrishna order was established on, I think, 31st May of 1898 or 97. And they used to meet very regularly, mostly at Balaram Bose's house. That means weekly meeting, monthly meeting, in that way they used to meet. And as a part of that meeting, someone used to read a good article, a composition. That means they used to bring something spiritual to be read, and in that way just we sing songs, devotional songs. In that way, at the beginning, they had this, and the beginning of the agenda, they used to have some sort of spiritual talk. And Girish Ghosh naturally was a member of the Ramakrishna mission from the very beginning. So in one of the meetings actually, he read a paper in Bengali. So it is translated from Bengali from the minutes of the Ramakrishna mission, 19th sitting on August 29, 1897. So 31st May of 1897 it was established. It's just after 2 months, you can see. And that means May, June, July, August, 3 months actually. He read this article and it is recorded in the minutes. That means it is not that he read and it was lost. It was not. It is a part of that minutes. So Girish Ghosh is saying, we engage ourselves in controversy on self-effort versus God's grace, but do not ponder on how we could attain liberation of the spirit. So we are eager to get God's grace. And we feel that we have to make effort or not to make effort. In that way, the controversy always goes on. But in that controversy, we forget that the purpose of life, purpose of all the spiritual practices is to get liberation of the spirit. That means highest realization. So Ramakrishna used to say that both hold good. Two types of persons are apt to speak of God's grace, holy man and idler. So in that way they will say that holy man will say God's grace is not necessary because he has realized God, and idlers will say, well, yes, that means only God's grace can work for me. I don't need to work. In outward manifestation, Sattva and Tamas look alike. According to Vivekananda, Arjuna's words of dispassion, which we read in the beginning of the Gita, did not issue from the excess of Sattva, but from downright tamas. So the point is that at the beginning of the Kurukshetra, as we know the story, so by seeing or out of fear, this great what is called army in front of him, he actually was afraid. Not only afraid, he was also afraid of killing what is called friends and relatives. So in that way, it did not arise out of sattva. That means he did not want to quit because Vairagya has come for spiritual realization. He was really afraid, tamas. People, after finding for many a time their self-efforts failing, ultimately depend on the grace of God. Some sort of effort, that means going to feel revenge or praying to God for certain such thing and all those things, when they find that nothing is working, then they think of what is called praying for divine grace, God's grace. He who struggles for attaining peace does experience grace of God. We do not try to understand what is mukti or liberation of the spirit. We do not strive to free ourselves from the desire for worldly enjoyments and the resultant suffering, as if liberation is some kind of a title. That means we get it by our own right. It is like that. Many people ask, Can you not attain liberation through worldly living? What, however, needs to be known is that it is by devoting one's mind entirely to God one attains peace. Nowhere else is peace. If we can do that through living in the world, whether we live in a place, in a palace or in the forest, does not matter. So Girish Ghosh is saying that it is a matter of employing the mind or keeping the mind immersed into divinity or in God. The mental peace will come. There is no other way that mental peace will come. So it doesn't matter where actually, in what state actually you live, whether you are a monk, whether you are a householder, whether you live in forest, whether you live in palace. If we can keep our minds immersed in the thought of God, then there is little difference between living in the world or renouncing the world. Through repeated enjoyments, when our minds are fed up with worldly objects, we then go about seeking His grace. So in that way, actually, we seek grace of God. We need God's grace even to be able to feel His grace. That is a very interesting statement. That means we need God's grace even to be able to feel His grace. That means breeze of grace is really blowing, but it needs gross grace. That means we need to understand that we can feel that. So that understanding also requires God's grace. So it is, so he is putting this thing in such an intelligent way. Now he is telling his own story. That is the most important part. I met Sri Ramakrishna for the first time in the house of Dinanath Basu. Dinanath Basu lived in the vicinity. He was a very well known, what is called, advocate, that means lawyer of his time, and he used to live in Bagbazar, not too far from Balram Basu's house. So Sri Ramakrishna, he probably had invited once Sri Ramakrishna, and in that way Sri Ramakrishna went there. And being a Parosi, Parosi means they never. So Dinanath, being a well-known person or well-known person of that area, so he invited his neighbors. Girish Ghosh also was in the neighborhood, so he was also invited. I met Sri Ramakrishna, Girish Ghosh is saying, for the first time in the house of Dinanath Basu. It was night already. In a state of absorption, he was asking if it was not yet evening or still there was daylight. So that was the photographic description when Sri Ramakrishna was alighting from his cab, that means horse carriage. So he was in a mood that he could not figure out whether it was day or whether it was night. On hearing this, I thought that this man is a hypocrite, because it is in clear eyes, you can see it is evening. Why is he saying that? So he surmised that he is a hypocrite. Thinking thus, I left the place, little knowing at that time that through love of God, a man could attain a state in which he lost the sense of distinction between day and night. So he left. That means it is not, he was a very straightforward person. He thought that he is a hypocrite, why should be here? So he actually went away. Later on, actually, he could figure out that it may happen to a spiritual person. I took his divine state of being as hypocrisy. The cause of our suffering is that due to force of habit, we cannot get rid of our attachment to desire-actuated work. He is the holy man who intends to free himself from it, from this suffering. He is the holy man who intends to free himself from it, from this suffering. But there is no such affliction in place of which we cannot attain peace by taking refuge in him. So he is extolling, surrendering himself to God. That is the best way, or the secured way of getting peace of mind. I believe by calling on God with utmost sincerity, we can get rid of any danger. Not to have called upon the merciful God in this life is indeed meanness. We do not really understand the distinction between self-effort and divine grace. That we have not taken refuge at the feet of the merciful Lord is the real calamity. So this is the observation of Girish Chandra Ghosh, who is an embodiment of self-surrender. Then question, what is your opinion about avatar, that means incarnation of God? That because of his the influence that he had of Sri Ramakrishna, naturally people wanted to know, that those who were present asked him, what do you think about avatar? What is your concept? What you call an avatar? Now, speaking of myself, I have never seen such love, referring to Sri Ramakrishna, in anyone else. He himself came to the theater and took me along with him. He used to say, quote, "I have no attachment, but only compassion. Everything has dropped off but compassion." Him I call the avatar, the Girish Ghosh is saying, him I call the avatar in whom I find compassion for all creatures. He used to say, "If by taking birth 1,000 times I can but help one, I shall deem myself blessed." That is Ramakrishna said. Swamiji also said, he used to say, quote, "Even if I have to go to hell for the liberation of others, I am ready for that." Then Girish Ghosh is saying, these words were not prompted by self-esteem, but by compassion for all creatures. It is not that they are so proud of themselves, or that means they could do such and such thing, that they are saying that. It is not like that. It is out of compassion that they said this. Among all the testimonies about his avatarhood, the most valuable is the oral testimony of the avatar himself. That means we do not, that also he is saying, when the Lord incarnated himself as Ramachandra, only 7 rishis could recognize him. There is no way of recognizing him. if he does not open our eyes and make us see. So this is the conclusion of Girishchandra Ghosh. That means he is saying, if avatar does not reveal himself, then otherwise actually it is not possible to recognize him. Avatar actually, in case of Sri Ramakrishna also, we see that though out of devotion, some devotees started declaring, Girish Ghosh was one of them, of course, Ramchandra Dutta was one of them. They used to say that Sri Ramakrishna is avatar. And also we see that there was an occasion during the young ages, that means before Sri Ramakrishna came into the life, that means Bhairavi Brahmani had thought. So in that way, she actually organized a meeting, and in that way he was declared that he is avatar. All these things happened, but still there is a big question mark. So until and unless avatar says that I am avatar, it is not possible to recognize avatar. And that had happened in case of Sri Ramakrishna. When Sri Ramakrishna is in a deathbed, so one day Narendranath thought that, well, if he can say, he was still doubting that whether Ramakrishna is an avatar or not. So he was still doubting. He thought that at this moment, at this crucial moment, that means he's dying of this illness, if he can say that I am avatar, that means if he can say that I am avatar, that is a sort of wager, if you call it, mental wager that he put. That means if he says at this moment, then I shall believe. That means I shall not doubt. There is no other way. And Sri Ramakrishna has actually read his mind, or whatever it may be. He said that the one that had born in the what is called in the past as Rama and Krishna is actually within this body. So in that way he declared himself to Swami Vivekananda. So Girish Ghosh is saying, when the Lord incarnated himself as Ramachandra, only seven rishis could recognize him. That means few persons could recognize him. There is no way of recognizing him if he does not open our eyes and make us see. So this is the answer to the question, what is your opinion about avataro? That means who can really understand avataro? Girish Ghosh clearly said, did Sri Ramakrishna bestow his grace on all who went to him? So another question was put to Girishchandra Ghosh. I believe that he did. But it so happened that on some rare occasions, what I considered to be a cruel treatment, afterwards I found through practical results to have been an act of supreme grace and not cruelty. This is also another aspect of avatara that we see. Avatara in past, that means Rama avatara, they kill people. People in a sense, that means they are bad people. In that way they kill. And how actually you can say that killing of person, that means this type of violence, can be considered to be a compassion? So Girish Ghosh also has seen some example in the what is called in the life of Sri Ramakrishna, which apparently struck him to be cruel. So he has given one example. It is not what is called cruel as killing, but still it is gives the impression of cruelty. So the incident is like this. He is saying, I believe that he did, but it is so happened that on some rare occasions, what I considered to be a cruel treatment, afterwards I found through practical results to have been an act of supreme grace and not cruelty. One day, he is giving an instance. One day he sternly turned Shashi away. Shashi means later Swami Ramakrishnananda was a great disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, and he served Sri Ramakrishna as long as he was alive. And later on actually he instituted the worship that we do. Actually he instituted and used to take care of Sri Ramakrishna's ashes and used to do daily worship. So he was so devoted to Sri Ramakrishna. So he is saying, one day he sternly turned Shashi away and did not allow him to get into the cab.